Chase, could I get you to lead us, please?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay. Did everyone have a chance to take a look at the minutes for May the 22nd? If so, and there's no additions or corrections, I entertain a motion to approve the minutes. It's been moved by Goodman and seconded by Miller. Those in favor signify by raising your right hand. It was unanimous. Thank you very much. And then the Board of Public Works and Safety meeting on the meetings on the 10th and the 24th are for information. Okay, now I would like to open the session, the public hearing. And public hearing involves vacating the alley to the south of 712 Main Street from Main to the north, the south alley to west of the property. And that would be Chris Van Dyne.
I'm filling in for Chris.
Oh, you're filling in?
Yeah.
I didn't think I saw him out there anywhere. Step right up to the podium and identify yourself, please.
I'm Jared Tyler, co-owner operator of To the Canoe Brews. And we're here today to talk about vacating the alley. We talked about electrical panels at the Board of Works meeting. We have these paperworks here, kind of showing. I got a couple of them here. Shows where our panels would be located in the alley.
Don't be nervous.
I know, okay. But I'm fine. Just give me a minute. Okay.
They're all pretty calm up there.
Right.
Don't be nervous.
Okay. So anyway, if you look through there, it shows what we plan to do, where the electrical panels would be. We'd like to keep the power panels on our building. Our neighbors have been nice enough to allow us to have an option to put the panels on their property and run the lines underground. One problem that we have a 4-foot outward swinging door into that alley space that will be used for the renters that will be going upstairs in and out. It's also their fire escape from the apartments. We then have a 36-inch out swinging door at the end of our brew house. Then those doors cause problems there in the alley if you have them open. And there's quite a bit of traffic there going to Harry's place, and so that alley is pretty busy, and we all have young kids ranging from middle school to elementary level, and so we would like to vacate that alley.
Now you're not talking about the north south alley. That's Harry's.
No.
That's the busy alley.
Right.
Yeah,
well, right. But we're
that's
talking.
The one Harry.
Right.
You know, didn't want you jumping out of your seat.
No, that's not the one we're talking about.
That would eliminate your drive.
That's not what we're talking about. I was just saying that those two, when they cross there, it's
right.
Messy.
Right.
And those, we come out of the building and around the corner there. And so.
Let me help you out, Jared.
Okay.
As you know, Chris, I think. Mike, were you at the Board of Works meeting?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Chris did not that you're not doing a good job, but he did a great job of going through every detail, and it led to the Board of Works saying, well, you know, we don't make the decision, but we can certainly recommend it to the City Council. So I'd like to read the letter to the City Council from the Board of Works. And if you see that anything's not correct, please let us know.
Okay.
Dear council members, the Rochester Board of Works and Safety met on June the 7th and discussed the possibility of an alley closure in the 700 block of Main Street on the west side of Main between Bailey's, Chris Van Dyne's building, and Karen Brown's beauty shop, as well as Lance Nelson's Edward Jones property. These three property owners would be affected by the closure. All three building owners were present and agreed as to how the closure would be handled relative to each acquiring rights. One half of the alley. Well, that's not exactly true. There are two on the other side that would get a quarter and a quarter, but you get the idea. It was agreed that the alley would be blocked even with the building fronts on Main Street, leaving a drive area off Main that was the entrance to be marked as handicapped parking. And we have an ordinance request covering that. What they're talking about is the area, the chute that comes in off of Main Street. would be a handicapped spot. And one thing Karen Brown had, and Lance, said they needed more handicapped parking in that area. And I guess Karen has folks who come from the senior citizens bus would come in there and they could drop off at that spot.
On the sidewalk?
Well, if you go down and look, you've got a chute area.
Yeah.
That would be handicapped.
But aren't you blocking sidewalks going each way then?
I pictured the parking spot being on Main Street itself.
Yeah, I'm assuming it's gonna be here just before, so it's not something more like that.
Right, just to, right.
Right, just at the entrance.
At the entrance of the alley. At the entrance of the alley is where the blocking gonna be. And you know, they're making it sound like they're closing off the alley. As Chief Butler even said in one of our earlier meetings, it's still gonna be open for emergency vehicles to get down the alley.
Yeah.
So it's just basically gonna be closed off for normal everyday traffic.
So parking still on the road.
That there will still be parking there for the handicaps in front of that closure, like there is across the street.
And of course, foot traffic would still be able to go in and out of.
Yeah, the people that walk them down, they'll have no problem going up down.
The rear of the alley to the west where it crosses with the alley going north and south would be closed with signage stating it was privately owned, not eligible for public traffic. The rest of the alley crossing the north and south alley would continue on west, open to the public as before. The designation as a private drive is again to, for Karen Brown's benefit, her employees park along the north side of her building right there, so they'd still be able to get in there and park. One thing that was noted today that I would strongly suggest you get on the deed when this is done is that that drive area was designated for her parking site only. I could see some folks in the future, you know, you guys will have half of it, pass that along and don't remember any of this. Somebody could have employees parking in there. Well, then she's blocked up. So we need to designate somewhere on your deed that that was what that was about. This plan was agreed upon by the owners to solve a problem for the Van Dyne Group relative to the safe location of the 443 phase electrical system necessary to power the brewery. Board of Works voted unanimously to recommend this closure to the City Council. Signed, Mayor Dan, Board of Works Rick Bigwell, Board of Works John Little. That pretty much
sums it up pretty good.
Okay.
Am I able to ask a question?
Yeah, we'll open it up on the floor. What's the question?
What's the difference between closing and vacating?
Well,
I would be in favor, I think, of it being closed and allow them to do what they need to do and everybody have access to it. But I'd like to see the city consider maintaining ownership of that alley so it doesn't get built on. My fear is because you can build right to a property line, if you give this property over to these two different property, three different property owners, they can literally build up to the property line.
Not with setbacks.
There are no setbacks downtown. There are no setbacks on that. That's why the Bailey's building sits on the property line. You could build all the way out to the alley wall.
But the alley is still gonna be vacated, right? And when it's vacated, and we are still gonna maintain, we will be taking care of it, correct, as a city? I would assume not.
No, it becomes their property.
Well, I would think it would be appropriate to keep, just because it does access your city parking lots, and it will be accessing pedestrian traffic. It'd be nice to keep the alley, the city in the ownership of it, but allow just the closing of it so you don't have vehicles going down it.
I had discussed that with Casey. Now, she has nothing on an alley being closed. It's vacated.
Well, we've closed the alley right across the street from it.
Unofficially. That alley is still on record as being a public alley.
So
you
want to
drive through there, Harry, you're perfectly legal.
But you can't drive through it because
no.
There's a telephone pole there.
No.
I mean, we could put something in there. Next to B&B building is another one that's still city-owned property.
That is an active alley as on record, as such, yeah.
Right.
There's nothing that designates those, it's just been one of those, gee, we just did this thing. We really don't have any avenue for closure.
I just think it'd be nice if the city could figure out a way to close it without, and still maintain ownership of it, so it doesn't get, you don't run into property disputes in the future, or who knows, 50 years from now, what the property owner wants to do with the building. You know, it potentially could be outdoor dining area, it could be a lot of very nice things, it could be an art alley, it could be a lot of things that would be very attractive for downtown, but if you close it, then the property owners could do whatever they want with that section.
Casey's not here, but like I said, we've had that discussion, we don't have anything that talks about a closure as opposed to vacating an alley. And the two alleys that seem to fall in that category were done unofficially. And I don't know how they did it, especially the telephone pole being stuck. But they are still listed on the rolls as being alleys.
Well, and they can still be listed as an alley. It's just not one that you can drive down.
Not sure how we do that. I mean, it's either an alley.
You've got two right there now, I don't know how we did it, but that would be my recommendation anyway, I think would be that the city considered maintaining ownership of the property. Just for the good of the community, so they can have access to that alley.
Harry, one of the concerns that came up at the Board of Works meeting is exactly what Mr. Tyler mentioned. They are going to be having part of their electrical system is going to be in the alley.
I understand.
So we as the city, the concern the Board of Works had is putting that on city property and how the liability falls with that. That was their concern from that perspective, the same as if they were to locate it off-site of their own property. So if another property owner was gracious enough to allow them to put a pedestal for the electric there, but off of their site, now what kind of liability does that pose for them and for the other property owner, even with agreements? So.
For the chicken coop comes around the side of the building. I mean, that's the access, that's why that telephone pole's there.
No, I know, but for them, because they were talking, what the issue was is they were looking at, they have to relocate their electric from the north side to the south side of the building, which then puts it into the alleyway, how far?
About 3 feet.
3 feet into the alley.
Once you get the pylon.
Yeah, so that was part of that Board of Works conversation that when they came to the Board of Works thinking that was the place where they needed to come to get permission.
And that area is 10 feet total.
Right.
That was where they circled back around to the vacation, just because of the electric.
And when we first started talking electrical, when Duke was walking around the back figuring out where they could put the three-phase service, they told us our only option was on the north side of the building because of where the short space in the back and the apartments and the stairs and that. And that's why we moved forward with this. And then I think we stated in the Board of Works meeting that's, you know, for our property, it's nice to have our power on our property instead of on somebody else's property, whether it's an easement or whatever it is. But, you know, we're not saying that public and people can't go down and yeah, we'd like to have those nice things that you talked about in that alley, and we feel that would be awesome for our business. And then you think about the safety aspect of the doors, tenants in and out, going to apartments on the third and second floor. They're not always gonna park on Main Street, they'll probably park back behind and come in that alley and go upstairs, and we have to have that exit anyway.
And for those of you in the audience who don't understand the vacation of an alley or don't realize it, when an alley is vacated, the city gives it up and it goes to the property owners. Well, the property owner on one side gets half of it, the property owner on the other side gets half of it, so you'll have 5 feet now that basically becomes a new property line. As will the other building owners.
Sure.
Which is, I think, what Harry's concerned.
Yeah, that's exactly the point. Either that or it gets deeded so that they can't develop any building structure on it, so they can maintain access through there. Because there's nothing that, with the current zoning, that would prohibit them from anybody from building right up to that property line.
No, you're right.
And so then, you know, then you're going to really have neighbor versus neighbor. somebody's wanting vehicle access to their parking area and the other one wants to put a shed there, they can do it.
Well, with the water lines and everything that, and the gas lines that are currently running down the alley on that, actually would be on my property anyway. We have no plans to actually do any kind of an extension of the building or anything like that. We have discussed doing like an art ball or something like that, possibility of maybe the guys might be interested in doing some sort of outdoor seating area, but there is no plans. We've never even been a thought to do any kind of building construction.
And then, but kind of to go what Harry's saying, Karen's was on fire 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Say there was a different owner or she owns it.
Sure.
It burns down. You have to rebuild. Are you going to rebuild a smaller building or are you going to take advantage of 5 extra feet that you now have? I mean, and that's, in that case, is if it burnt to the ground and you're starting over, you're probably going to use your whole property. So I get what Harry's saying on,
yeah,
it might be good to make sure, I mean, I'm all for doing this, but making sure that people can access that alley as needed.
Definitely.
I mean, that'd be an extreme case.
You just never know with the future.
But you don't know.
Yeah.
Well, on the same token, if that scenario evolved, the Van Dykes can buy the whole thing and then build clear across.
I don't believe Tom would ever let that happen. Let us the building burn to the ground.
He would be there plenty of time, I'm sure.
That's a lot of pressure.
If the alley is vacated and the other two property owners have an occasion to sell it, you buy it, there's nothing to stop you from building clear across.
I mean, I'd love to see the area used as beer garden space on special occasion events like the local fest or something like that. And they do that in Warsaw. They'll set up their, they have their art alleys and they let the local restaurants use that area for tables temporarily, and they set it up and have a nice outdoor dining area. But it's not, it's still the city of Warsaw's property. And then they clear it all up. And, you know, I don't, maybe there needs to be some kind of liability agreement about this area where the power is, but that's my only guess.
Well, we're working with the tools that we have on hand to talk about this set of legislation. Put in place. You can't have nothing on a closure. It's vacant. And apparently, it must have been a little bit of a concern or difficulty in the past because these two alleys that you mentioned never had any official action on them. They're just encroached.
Just because it hasn't been done, that doesn't mean we don't do it, or should we look into it?
For someone to rebuild, as you're continuing to rebuild, they would still have to go to Casey to get permission to not rebuild on their footprint of their previous property to expand. And then,
downtown it's different than residential, and I agree with Harry. I think you have to the property line.
You can build all the way to the alley.
There's no code violation that Casey could tell somebody they can't build over to the middle of the alley they own.
Yeah, I don't believe there's a setback in that situation.
Yeah, I don't think so. Which is why you see buildings side by side, nothing in between them. That's how they work.
We vacate with the laws that you can't build on it.
Yeah.
Either their property or condition of sale.
You can sell the alley? No, you can't sell the alley.
Okay.
You vacate, you could use an easement. That is, you can grant the vacation and the owners could sign an easement, like an easement for emergency vehicle ingress and egress, let's call it. And the city, you record that easement, and the city would have a check over their ability to do that. It would not be statutory, but it would be contractual, essentially. And so that if they said, we want to do this,
once the ordinance is granted, but not under any obligation to do that. We can't grant it with the condition that they do that.
I just think you could grant it with an easement.
No, no. You could, they do separate things. You could grant it, and then they could turn around and grant the easement. The owners would grant the city an easement. And for that matter, you probably could do the entire easement first, and it would, I think, take effect on that parcel once it was vacated. But you can't build something, what I'm saying is you can't build something into the ordinance as conditional.
Yeah.
We pass this ordinance only if they sign the subdivision.
Were the alleys put in originally, I think in the east-west alleys, the north-south alleys, of course, they were put in, there was trash dumpsters and stuff in the back of those, deliveries and stuff. But the east-west alleys, I mean, were they, or would they not have been, Chief Butler, would they have been put in the small towns, I guess, four fire blocks?
Fire break in between, I mean, you
fire
could
break,
have.
Break, sorry.
I mean, but as far as getting a vehicle down there and parking an engine there during an active fire, no.
You couldn't get 10 feet. You couldn't get the
width. No, I couldn't do it. And then I mean, there's so many other factors you got to worry about. I mean, you couldn't work around your truck.
Yeah.
I couldn't open the doors. I couldn't get equipment off. I mean, it has no use besides, like we did, like when Karen had her incident, we came down the north-south alley behind the building with another engine and set up down there. So we had trucks in front and trucks in the back. But
your main thrust was
we walked up and down it, but there was no no apparatus parked in it.
East-west would have been more of a fire break.
Correct. I mean, maybe back when they had their wagons, they fit a little more easily, but our big trucks aren't going to fit.
Yeah.
Okay, any other comments from the
can we just
publish the building code?
We don't want that to take place. Could we just change that? Put in a setback downtown? Everyone's grandfathered in, but
whoa. You could. You can make any legislation you want. Casey, we're here tonight. She probably have three reasons why you shouldn't.
But I think if we did that, then just we're going to have a lot of exceptions.
Yeah.
Versus we need one exception right now. We need to figure out how to make this one issue instead of make a rule and have a ton of exceptions.
Well, and two.
And it's not an issue even right now. Like I said, in 20 years, 30 years, 50
right,
years, new owners,
talking
you know,
about what
might happen.
Well, excuse me, but it is an issue right now. But your business is going to be stymied.
Yeah, we need.
If we don't.
We need to. We have all of our panels inside and out. They're ready to be mounted and ready for Duke to roll. So we can get our. We have equipment rolling this week on Thursday and Friday. We'll get another batch of equipment the following week. We need to get this stuff up and get going.
Yeah.
Our space is ready for our equipment. We've worked very hard and spent a lot of money. And we would really like to get going on this.
I realize that's an issue. I'm saying if we
right.
vacated the two owners right now, it wouldn't be an issue. I know you guys wouldn't build them.
Right.
And have time in the future to review this a little bit more and add something else in somewhere.
Well, and two, the vacation, you're going to have a deed put in place for everybody involved. They'll have the deed and say put a codicil in there. I strongly suggest a codicil about the parking. That was just thought of recently, that parking situations for Karen only, that was her big concern in doing this. And you can't have somebody down the road, you guys aren't there, there's somebody else, you can't have their employees lining up back there, but now she can't get out.
For the point that Harry brought up, if there was to be a loss of a structure downtown and someone wanted to extend then on their property, how about if we just change the building code where it says that any reconstruction can only take place on the footprint of the existing structure now, regardless of property lines that changed? So you couldn't go ahead and say you're buying the whole block and make a mega building, everything has to be in this existing footprint that it's on now. I mean, is that a possibility, a negative, a positive? It would extend them from going into 35 feet of the alley. They could only exist or rebuild on the footprint that they currently have now. And that would be a change in the building code.
And that's got to be one of the smallest buildings downtown. You know, you'd think that if they wanted to rebuild it, go back as well. You wouldn't want to restrict them from not being able to go back. There's a lot of buildings that are only halfway back. What if they want to go farther back?
Oh, what if they wanted to go back to the north-south alley?
Yeah.
It's their property. The other thing that comes to mind, we've got a whole block and a little farther down the street that White Gunter is investing in. And if we'd have had any break in those buildings, what would we have done there? They're all together, thank goodness. So it makes a big area. But if there had been a break there, how would we have handled that? I don't know. It's right now, though, we have a set of tools. And so this may not, you know, this whole thing evolves around the fact that you don't have any property lines. Your property line is your building shape. And you've got some infrastructure issue with your electrical. What if a month down the road you find out you got to have a larger gas main, and that's going to sit out there too? You can sure use that 5 feet area. I think we've got to take a look at the tools we have if we want to do something different in the future.
What about having them list City of Rochester's additional insured, close the alley, not surrender the property, and have them put a liability limit that they have to list as additional insured in the City of Rochester?
Are you mulling that over?
Well,
yeah, that's what I meant
to. Insurance company, are they going to say there's no insurable interest there? Do they allow that? But assuming they do, and they say they don't care, and you're paying a premium. I don't know what kind of dispute ensues when a check for a loss arrives and the city has to decide what its interests are worth.
What was your point exactly here? Just them putting an additional limit of liability?
Well, if the reason for vacating is because the city doesn't want to be liable for this meter base and the potential injury that could happen from somebody hitting it, then maybe they list the city as being covered. Hanging over city property. Is it actually going to be touching the alley, or is it just going to be hanging over?
It's sticking out.
Sticking out. There's 10 feet over it.
Yeah. And
if Ballard's protecting it, that kind of stuff.
Trying to go down through there with a 3/4-ton truck from Arizona, so you'd be in it. I can answer your question, and I'm not a lawyer. If it got down to somebody being sued, the city'd be on that list too, don't you think? I mean,
It becomes
everybody involved. Yeah.
It's the safety of the electrical panel and people hitting the panel, but it's also the safety of the people exiting our building.
Well, you brought that issue up too.
So
you're landlocked.
Yeah.
The other aspect of that is, like I said, you may have other things come along before you go over the courts and say, I need a couple feet out there. Now you would have a property line, whereas right now you don't. I don't know, gentlemen. We have a certain set of tools we have to work with. Anything?
I would like to make a motion that we.
Let me close the meeting.
Oh, sorry.
There's another comment.
Yes, sir.
What is wrong with the city keeping the property as is and their own thing and putting a Ballard in the end of the alley with a no driving sign on one of our buildings? or on the Ballard itself, just like most major cities that I've constructed parking lots with for years. They have many old alleys that are tight like ours, and they vacated them because of traffic driving through for the people walking. So what keeps the city from still owning their property? Because I'll put crosswalks across the alleys, even though they're Ballarded and no driving traffic.
Well, what we were saying, we have no provision in any of our legislature to do that. We have the vacating of an alley, and that's basically, we don't have anything about closure. Which you're probably talking about some of the larger cities. They've established an ordinance or made it part of their zoning that you could do a closure.
They generally poured a curb.
Yeah.
They matched curb across.
Yeah.
And then in our incident, we would put most of that curb that we're replacing is going to be a big wide ADA with the blind man bumps and all that for the feeling. You know, that would be a basic, you know, it would be just a new parking stall is what it would turn into. But nobody has to exchange properties. The city could still maintain it if they wanted. They wouldn't really have to. But, you know, and I mean, I was just saying for like snow removal or whatever, like they normally do. But the Ballard, our whole back end where Webb's and everybody meets in the inner circle of that block would still be open and still be, cars could travel as they needed. But the only people that would be pulling in the small building of Karen's would be people that know that they can pull back there and park.
Perfect.
It's not, there's not going to be people flying through the alleys at 25 or 30 mile an hour and me grabbing my 3-year-old son again and dragging him back because, yeah, we have already had a few incidences where people are being careless.
Well, I'm sure you have.
Right.
Because that is a public alley.
You know, and we're, you know, this is what was our biggest worry was opening that door. As the car hits the door, who cares about the car? It's the person that gets smashed through the door once the car hits it.
No, I hear what you're saying. It is a dangerous situation. And if we do something that we don't really have an ordinance or a zoning regulation to do, that's very unofficial. And that's what I don't want to get into. I don't want to get into something where there is an incident. God knows what would happen, and maybe somebody went down there who didn't understand what was going on. And we had an incident, and then there's three lawyers who find out, oh, it's still the city's alley.
I mean, I think the city owns the alley. They could open or close any alley they want. They don't have to surrender the property. Can't they just put a Ballard up and it's still the city's alley?
That's unofficial. That's
it's just
what was
been
done
closed
the
to vehicle traffic.
Alleys.
It's not. Anything but that. It's still an alley.
So me driving in the city of Rochester on any streets, if something happened to me driving, I'm not saying this, but I'm just saying in general, I have the right to pursue the city on a lawsuit also.
Yeah.
You know?
Anything.
It's happened before. Signage has been knocked down or signage is inappropriate or, I mean, that has
right.
happened in the event.
But what I'm walking around the bush about is just that it's like that can happen right now with no Ballards, no nothing in the alley. Right now, somebody could spin sideways, hit our building, bounce off the Karen's
sure.
building, and roll their car, and
sure.
then still sue the city.
Sure.
Because the alley's too tight.
Sure.
You know, they could come up with any reason. You know, that's all I'm looking at is I'm just trying to see both sides of the.
Sure, but your alley situation right now is grandfathered back to 1906. But you start throwing electrical on the side of the building or anything else out there that restricts that from the 10 feet, then you've opened up a whole other sack of worms or cats. Yeah.
Mayor, just in response to that, Harry's question about the insurance raises another aspect of that, and that is that if we did that and if we're still owned and then there were a loss to the new electrical equipment that is by definition not entirely on their property, I wouldn't trust their insurer to pay on that when they look at it and say that's in an alley that's owned by the city. We won't insure you for loss to someone else's property. And so I think you could create a real fiasco there if there's loss to the
Can the city sell a portion of the alley? Do they sell just enough land to accommodate their needs?
I don't think we can sell anything.
I would have to research. I don't think there's any way we can vacate part of it. And when it came to us, it came to the city as a public way. And I would have to talk to Casey to do some research on that to see if there's any way that we could do that. I think what I would find, and I'm psyched, but I think what I would find is, say, if it's a public way, be it a road or an alley or something, the reason the vacation ordinance exists is that if an area is platted and you say this is a public way, you're saying to the city, you have control over this. It's not the same as selling the deed of the road to the city. And because of the way the vacation is designed, the city is simply stepping away or surrendering its ownership, and it reverts back to kind of its natural state or whatever it was beforehand. And I think what I would find is that is in place to recognize that it came to us as a public way. If it's going to leave the city's hands, it has to revert back to what it was. We can't simply deed off roads as separate parcels and sell them. I know that for sure. No one's ever asked me that, but I think I would find that selling part of an alley certainly couldn't. I don't know. Maybe we might be able to vacate part of an alley, but I don't.
So
even if we vacate it, those easements are still in place.
Those easements are in place.
They have the forever easement.
And so you wouldn't be able to build.
You'll never be able to build.
Yeah, and there are gas lines, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's where they hit on the north side of the building.
So
and there's a ton of fiber wire through there, too.
RTC won't let someone build, so.
They need access, they won't.
As long as they have easements there.
And to your point, Andy, we are vacating half an alley in this situation.
Yeah,
alley goes all the way through east and west. We're vacating it to the crossing point there at the north and south.
I just, that other one, like you were saying, it was just, and the only reason I know is because it's not even.
Okay, there are no more questions or comments. I will close the public meeting and call for some action on this request from the council.
Traffic down, and that's all.
Yeah.
Do we have to have a specific reason?
Which I
just to be able to trespass.
Yeah, I that we can do that anywhere in town without easement, as long as. Yeah, we don't have any firemen saying, do we have easement here?
Yeah, you have permission to come on.
Yeah, Smith Square.
Put me by it around.
Bernie, we'll give you a call.
Yeah.
It's no different than water lines. You know, we're looking at putting in a 4-inch water line in there to assist the brewery with their, with water. So the water and the gas lines are actually within about 2 foot of the building and go across the street to go to the east side of Main Street for hookups. So that's why, you know, you'd never see any, nobody's going to build.
You're not going to build over that. And by the way, that wouldn't be an easement for us in that instance. We are at the street and the entrance effort would be the building owners from the tap of the street. They'd be responsible for the 4-inch tap and the line going in. So it'd be on their property.
Does that resolve the issue about there possibly being building into the alley or any future purpose in with the gas and water lines?
Yeah, that's what you're saying.
That won't ever change.
With the pool that's going to be behind Karen's building in that little area there, you'd never build the entire length of that, like the length of our building there, because you're going to have a pool with three phase cans on it back there as well.
Yeah, that's the other thing that we failed to mention there. There is a pole that's going to be moved that will encroach in some of that area.
Yeah.
And that's a Duke's doing there.
That's a Duke.
We can't pick where they put their pools.
You know, widen the opening. The pole is moving closer to the south, so it opens up the opening between our panels and anything.
That's a really slender squeeze with the pool being where it's at now. And I had our electrician talking to the Duke engineer today. They still plan on putting the pole where they plan on putting it. Obviously, they're not going to roll on anything until we figure out.
Well, and this has not been easy by any means. No. Oh my gosh! If I may be so candid as to tell about the initial thought was to put all this on the north side of the building. Well, you know, Duke doesn't run three-phase 440 across the rooftop like that to get over. So the pole would have to be moved. And their estimation of where that would go was the middle of Gail's Pet Store's front door. Yeah, which not a good deal, not a good thing. So then that brings everything back to the other side of the building. So it's been an ordeal, hasn't it? What does the council want to do?
Are we Mason idea of vacating and asking for an easement on the property? Is that an option?
What would the purpose of the easement be for the city?
Well, I guess, as I understand it, the purpose would be anything that an existing utility easement could not prevent. A separate, fresh easement post-vacation would give the city a little more authority to prevent things that are described. I don't know, I'm talking head, I don't know where that line is. I mean, what can you do that's not offensive to the existing utility easement that is more than we would want to see happen? That's what this is.
Dig up that alley to put a foundation down for a new building anyway if you have water, gas, fiber, all of that there. So I think really the option to build the buildings together would be, you wouldn't be able to do that anyway because of all the utilities that.
Well, and those are permanent easements. They don't put that stuff down without that assurance. Do I have a motion regarding ordinance 03-2018?
02-2018.
vacation.
The 02 is in your packet that I emailed you.
Oh.
It was included with your vacation.
03 is the handicap parking. Vacation.
Well, for purposes of putting it on the floor, I'll move to approve ordinance number 02.
I have a reading, first reading.
I'll move to read first reading in its entirety.
I'll second that. Those in favor of the first reading of ordinance 02-2018 in its entirety, signify by raising your hand. Okay, unanimous.
Ordinance number 2-2018, ordinance vacating public ways, Rochester Township, Fulton County, Indiana. Whereas Crescendo LLC have petitioned for the vacation of a public way in Rochester Township, Fulton County, Indiana, owners of real land within original and subsequent plats of the plat of the town of Rochester and the city of Rochester, more particularly described as follows. An east-west alley lying between lot 60 and lot 61 and running the same length as lot 60 and 61, located in the plat of the town of Rochester, a platted subdivision located in the city of Rochester, Fulton County, Indiana. Whereas a public notice of a public hearing was published in the Rochester Sentinel on the 12th day of June 2018 per state law, and a public hearing was held on the 26th day of June 2018 to allow interested parties to make their comments and concerns known. And whereas the Rochester Common Council duly considered the petition and proposed ordinance and determined that the ordinance should be adopted, therefore be ordained that east-west alley line between lot 60 and 61 and running the same length as lot 60 and 61, located in the plat of the town of Rochester, a plat of subdivision located in the city of Rochester, Fulton County, Indiana. And Rochester, Indiana is hereby declared vacated subject to the rights of all public utilities currently existing within said alley.
Discussion. I would entertain a motion for the second reading, 02-2018.
By title only?
By title only. It's up to you guys.
I'll second that.
You make that motion by title only. Councilman Eric made the motion. Do I have a second?
Yep.
Councilman Heidi, second by title only. Oh, yes, those in favor. It's unanimous.
Ordinance number 02-2018, ordinance vacating public ways, Rochester Township, Fulton County, Indiana.
Okay. Any discussion? I would entertain a thought, a motion to suspend rules and have the third reading this evening.
So moved.
Second.
Ordinance number 2-2018, ordinance vacating public ways, Rochester Township, Fulton County, Indiana.
Okay. Any discussion? I would call for a vote then on 02-2018. All those in favor of...
I make a motion for the adoption of ordinance number 2-2018.
Okay, thank you very much. Second by Councilman Garrett. Those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Okay, it's unanimous. Those in favor of passing ordinance number 02-2018, signify by raising your right hand.
We'll have to read that. It's a whole separate ordinance, right?
No, I'm sorry. I called for a vote. We already.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
We'd already done that.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I got ahead of the game there. Okay. So 02-2018 passes. Now, 03-2018 involving the handicap parking of the Jabers Creepers. Do I have a motion to read for the first time 03-2018? All three very long pages. Anyone want to make that
motion? Mr. Mayor, I would interject here that your local rules, if it's unanimous, do not require a full reading of the ordinance. If it's unanimous, you can
Okay.
Thank you, Andy.
I will make that motion by title only.
No, you're being denied. We've never had anybody give a slide like that. There's a motion to have the first reading of 03-2018 by title only. Do I have a second? Oh, Goodman seconds that. Those in favor? Oh, you guys. I didn't even read it.
I read it. You were always been here all night.
Okay, it was unanimous.
Ordinance number 03-2018, an ordinance regarding handicap parking spaces.
Any discussion?
Make a motion for the second reading of ordinance 3-2018 by title only.
Second. Okay, it's moved by Goodman and seconded to have a second reading in the, okay, by title only, and that is unanimous.
An ordinance, ordinance number 3-2018, ordinance regarding handicap parking spaces.
I entertain a motion to suspend the rules and have the third reading by title only.
So moved.
Second. Okay, moved and seconded. Those in favor?
Ordinance number 3-2018, ordinance regarding handicap parking spaces.
Do I have a motion to adopt 03-2018?
May I ask, does this ordinance specifically talk to the handicap spot that we were talking about with the Bailey Building?
This would essentially give the Board of Works the authority to designate a handicap spot. So no, it doesn't speak to that one.
Okay, because I'm still confused about the way this letter reads from the Board of Works on this handicap spot. It seems to me that it's saying people will pull off of Main Street and into this ramp, which would cut off pedestrian cross traffic.
If we would go clear up to the barricades, but we will stop at the curb.
I see.
At the curb, yeah.
And one right here is how responsible. I was like, you have to understand the rule right here. This is a spot.
Right.
This is the spot.
This letter, it says we want to walk above the street and then we end up on the sidewalk.
It's there off of Main Street over here.
It's like that.
Traffic. There's enough room there after the walking there.
In the Board of Works and Defense Council, the conversation had a couple different conversations about that area. One of it was temporary polling. That is just temporary for drop off and pickup. And then they talked about actually making a permit, not across the sidewalk, but the curb up. Pull up to the curb.
That would make a lot more sense. Because if you pull in, you're blocking pedestrian traffic and then trying to back out of that with cross traffic behind you would be impossible.
Right. So they had a couple of different conversations during the board meeting, but I think ultimately what they ended up is exactly what you were saying, is that there would be a stop.
That was my
question. You ride a bicycle on a sidewalk, you can't park your car on it.
Actually, John, that was never a sidewalk, that was a panel.
Feel free to
okay. Well, it's not going to be, is it?
Touche.
Thank you.
Okay. Did we take care of that? No.
Well, you need to vote yet. Marty has
we need a vote.
I just asked, well, I'll move to approve ordinance number 03-2018.
Second. It's moved and seconded. Those in favor? Okay. It's unanimous. Thank you. Okay. Yeah. I did. That's what I was trying to think. Okay. us now, communications update on SCLA public sign. Valerie, you've stuck it out for quite a while. Did you learn everything you wanted to know about Alley?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
Take care, Mike.
Thank you very much.
So I'm supplied with an update tonight on the sign. I'm not sure, I've heard that, that we don't need a, we've already received our, when I say we, I mean a group from Home County Leadership Academy that we're all working on this together. There's 5 of us total. And I must have drawn the short stick, but that's all in discussion.
You sent the email.
I did. I'm trying to be proactive and move this along. I'm hearing that we're the second group to bring this project forward, and we're hoping to be the one that makes
it. Jacqueline? Was it that was here? No, or who are all 5 there?
All the 5 are myself, Chelsea Jameson from First Federal Savings Bank. We have Corbin Benzing from Pike Lumber, and then we have Jeremy Hackthorn with Orr County, and then we have Matt Calco with Polk County Metal Products.
Well, it wasn't Chelsea, but there was a young lady here with a young man, and gave the presentation and told us where it was going to go with the Board of Works. And
I think you're referring to the previous group that tried to,
This is
there was a previous group. Yeah, they're trying to get signed too.
Are we talking about the same sign?
I'd like to think so.
Okay. They came here recently.
Right. Yes, they came to the Polk County Leadership Academy. They were here in April and presented, this is the Lions Club location.
Yes.
Right.
To replace to take down the bowling alley location. And then replace it with the one adjacent to the Lions Club that is owned by the city.
I could check our minutes and such, but there were 2 people here and had the same location showing us.
Probably yes. It was me and a whole bunch of people. And then there was one.
But it was here at the council meeting. I don't believe they were the Board of Works.
They were at the Board of Works. Yeah, we had the Board of Works voted to let you go.
Yeah, you guys did.
Okay.
Well, here's the update. So out right now is to the orange spots that are painted onto the grass are where we would like to put the post, to put the sign. Myself and Matt and Lance with the RDP on the sign dimensions, and then also Casey Coles met out at this location and we had discussed. And so these 2 spots here for the posts are where it was agreed upon to put the post. We just wanted to update on the council, get any vote if necessary, and just kind of keep left-hand talking to right communication.
Casey was out and worked with you on the placement. Where was this? I went out and looked also, but I couldn't tell. The old one's been taken down.
Has it? Okay. It's been a little bit since I've driven on Old 3.
I sure couldn't find it. It's gone!
It's out by the bowling alley.
Yeah, it's far out by the bowling
alley. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
In
looking at this, and I know Casey's giving you a blessing, does anybody by chance think of just letting the Lions Club know about it?
Oh, yes. We went to them first.
Okay.
That's how we came here, because thought it was Lions Club property, and they told us, oh, yeah, we love it. This is a great idea, but it's not our property.
Very good.
Yes.
Yeah, that's just good policy.
Exactly. We started there, and it's been a learning experience from there. Okay. So, absolutely. So, this is the design that Lance has provided me that RDP, Rochester Downtown Partnership, has agreed upon to be placed on these poles when they go into those little orange spots. And then, similar to the current sign that's out by the bowling alley, there'll be a bar that will have all of the supporting organizations in the community.
The service clubs.
Exactly, thank you. Represented as well under me. So, that is the update. Questions or issues, just let me know. But from there, 811 has been contacted to locate all of the underground utilities.
Oh, yeah.
And Rochester Telephone is working with them on the installation of the post and the removal of the old one as well. Hopefully, the next time I don't know if I'll need to come back and say it's done, but if you want me to, I can. But you know, once it's installed, you'll know when it's done.
I don't know if you have to come back.
Okay.
It's here, but I think we'd all love to see a finished product picture when you're got it up.
Absolutely.
Certainly drive out there, but.
Yeah, and then from, and even if, you know, even when we come back to kind of celebrate the whole project, we can give credit due to all of the other organizations in the community that are providing not only materials and time as well to kind of just fund the whole project. Just because they're not on the sign doesn't mean that they didn't donate any materials.
So I just have a question. Is that the same, if we did the sign out there by the hospital? Is that the same sign?
No, not just original.
Black Friday.
Don't believe so.
It's very similar.
It's a, which is a much.
Somewhere it says, right, somewhere on the one by the hospital, it says city of Frenchtown.
Right.
Yeah, because that was the old.
The old logo was.
I thought it had city origin.
Oh, yeah, it does say.
Of course, it's much bigger.
Does say on the shore.
On the face of the lake.
Anybody got any questions?
Oh, hell, we had a half hour discussion, should be shorter, bench, luster.
That's fair. Well, thank you so much.
Anybody here, just second, anybody have any questions?
Well, like, no, do we want to keep them?
Well, that's my question, because the signs are about welcoming to the city of Rochester, not just downtown, no offense. So that's why I didn't know if you guys, if the council would rather the signs be consistent or not, before they go into any kind of production.
Exactly, that's a good point.
It's just my personal choice, which I was going to keep it myself, but the city, but I've never been guilty of that. The city of Friendship and Pride, that was Councilman Bill Shore came up with that. And I don't know if his dad saw a lot of that, he said, on this dais for a lot of years.
That's why I'm not trying to cause another hour-long conversation, I'm just asking.
That's why I'm here, because this is the speak now or forever hold your peace.
Yeah. I kind of thought that was the case, so. That would be at the council's discretion.
Anybody have any thoughts one way or the other?
Is one exclusive of the other? I mean.
They would just be different.
You could make the wording the same as the sign at the airport, I don't think it would be objection to the bill being consistent. Simple photograph would probably make it work for you.
For the airport, not golf course.
By golf course.
Yeah, I don't think it's one or the other. Is Rochester on the banks of Lake Manitowoc's description? And then you can sign a slogan.
Do you mind adding City of Friendship to Pride?
Is that Lance back there? No, you're not. You're Terry. I'm sorry. I've seen like Lance once, and then Terry and then I'm like, oh my gosh.
I think Terry, Lance has copied the logo that came from the original city plan.
Okay.
That is, which is kind of the starting point, but it has been modified a little bit with that airport sign. And I think it'd be right away. I like using the logo, what the words say.
And that was the goal for Conduit anyway.
Right.
It's already on one side.
Well, I mean, we're all about the historical downtown corridor. The City of Friendship and Pride is pretty historical.
Yeah.
Preference on your.
I think it says on the shore, Lake Manitowoc there too. So it's on the banks.
You know, I drive by that every day.
I think it does.
I think it does.
But I think it does say on the shores. Valerie, you get to go for a drive.
Sweet.
What's that?
Spell it shores.
It's
a recognition.
You know what? His family may like that better. Yeah.
In an effort to not have to come back next month, would you prefer that if the other sign says shores, put shores, and then add the city of City of Friendship and Pride, and is there a specific location, like kind of in the corner on?
I think they actually put it right below, I don't know how they got it in there, but it does look good.
Okay. Yeah. So just whatever the one is out there right now, just kind of model to achieve?
Yeah.
Is that the?
I would agree. Okay. It's part of our history, too, you know.
Super.
Anything else before us?
Valerie, what's your background?
My background, I'm currently with Rochester Community Schools as a business manager.
Okay.
I have my master's degree in business administration, and I've had that for a number of years. I'm working on my CPA. My family, we live just north of 110, so we are outside of Fulton County, but we love Rochester. And my husband is a chief
and
Air Force.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, thank you for your husband's service, but also thank you for your service getting involved and working to this end. Thank you very much.
It's been a pleasure. It's an honor to have you head on as well. So,
thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we've taken care of the ordinance. So that takes us down to the department heads. Chief Butler.
For the month of May, structure fires, 4 in the city, 1 in Rochester Township, 1 in Richland Township, car fires, 1 in Rochester Township. Equipment fires, 1 in Richland Township. Burn complaints, 2 in Rochester Township. Calls for smoke, 1 in Rochester Township. Mutual aids, 1 in Liberty Township, 1 in Union Township, 1 in Newcastle Township. Auto fire alarms, 5 in the city, 1 in Richland Township, 1 in Rochester Township. Gas leaks, 1 in the city. Accidents, 3 in the city, 2 in Rochester Township, 2 in Richland Township, 1 in Rochester Township. And we went down to 1 in Miami Township. There, but we did.
Mm-hmm.
Medical assist, 18 in the city, 4 in Rochester, 1 in Richland. We drove the ambulance 4 times. Lift assist, 1 in Rochester Township. Investigations, 1 in Richland Township. Service calls, 1 in the city. Canceled calls, 4 in the city, 1 in Richland Township, 1 in Rochester Township, 1 in Henry Township. And we did a service project of prom parking for the Rochester High School for a total of 63 runs and 1 drill. Pending your questions, that concludes my report.
The prom parking and such where our firemen were there in their Class A uniforms. I get to a compliment the other day, not only about the display at the prom parking, but also at Marty's funeral. Our fellows looked really, really professional. Did a nice job. Any questions for Tom? Thanks, Chief. Chief Shots.
For the month of May, we had a total of 21 accidents. 18 of those were property damage, 3 were personal injury. We issued 96 total warnings, 52 were for traffic, and 44 were for city ordinances. Obviously, it's grass season, so we've been dealing with that, grass and trash and junk cars. There were a total of 124 offenses, 51 were traffic, 68 were criminal, 4 juvenile, 1 city ordinance. We had a total of 80 case reports for the month, 854 calls for service, 36 lockouts, 9 towed vehicles, and 36 people incarcerated. And then the crimes that those individuals were lodged for, I don't know if you see it stands out. We lodged 13 people in May for possession of meth, and then 2 for possession of heroin. So out of the 36, 15 were for either meth or heroin. On the lighter side of things, not to be Debbie Downer, our new hire, Mike Atkins from the county, he's slated to start July 2nd, Monday. He's already been through PERF approval. We're waiting on them to approve the hire date, which is just an email. We've got uniforms ordered. They're in already, so we're set to go July 2nd. triathlon last weekend, two weekends ago we had the triathlon. Went well. There's some upset people that were on the lake. We have that every year. No major issues. And then we've got the Living Local Fest this weekend and then the parade Saturday, which is, we'll see how it goes. That's all hands on deck. Club.
That starts at 10 o'clock.
The parade starts at 11.
Or 11.
So we will shut down roads at 10:30, get everything buttoned up and traffic off the route. And it's coming up 15th, north on Main, and then west on Main, dispersing from there. That's about all I have. Unless you guys have questions.
Yeah, I have to be there. And I'm a judge. Come out to the parade, everybody. Any questions for the chief?
Do we know who owns the property on 6th and Monroe Street?
6th and Monroe. Ross and Gertie's?
Yes.
That's the county.
Oh, it is?
No, yeah. It's not. Yeah. It's Debbie Adams, the original homeowner where the house burned.
Yeah, correct.
She still is listed as the owner. We've already given the...
I figured.
We've already given a warning. Obviously, we can't locate her. So we have to post it, and then we have to give the public notice for 10 days. And I just gave that to Shada to give the Lennox crew tomorrow, so we can get it mowed over.
We've been down this route, haven't we, attorney?
Yeah, I could find her there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At one point she agreed to sign a deed over, but I had to get a hold of her for something else.
And the county has not taken possession of it, or texts. I thought that's where we were on the last go around. So, remember, we were negotiating back and forth on it.
I was thinking it was coming up in the fall, but apparently they took a certificate to it.
I'd say that September would be probably September if it started in.
As of about 2 weeks ago on GIS, it still should occur.
I would expect probably come September if no one else bids it out, then they're going to have a certificate. We can make a request. One of the things that has changed in the last couple of years, I've talked before about when the county gets the tax certificate, they can convey it to us at no charge, if you will. One of the things that changed not too long ago is there's no longer a wait period. They don't have to wait until they're having their other certificate sales in the spring. They can have, they can have the tax sale on Tuesday, and if they take the certificate, they can sign us a certificate on Thursday. And we can start the notice process. And because that's a certificate, it's a truncated notice process. It's not a one-year redemption period.
I was thinking we had.
I know we've talked about that. I think.
Would you mind checking to see if they have the certificate? I was thinking they did, and we were asking about the transferring of the certificate to the city, and there was some reason why they didn't want to do that. And my comment at the time was, well, then somebody's going to have to keep track of mowing it. That would probably be the county.
Apparently didn't sell last fall at tax sale.
I'm thinking, they had the certificate on it. Anyway,
okay.
We'll check them out. I would like to say one other thing. I'd like to comment on your number of city ordinances that you responded to. You know, we've had three of the mayor's walks now, and we were on the east side for the first time Sunday. And I'm happy to report that most of the things we had seen had already fallen into this 44 number here. Your folks are doing a good job of addressing those things.
We'll try to stay on top of it.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, Marcus Holcomb, waste treatment plan. Hey, Marcus.
Normal plant testing. We just had our chemical startup in our new Allen building. That's for aluminum sulfate to treat phosphorus. We've only tested water only. We're still working in the lab on our QA, QC. That's our quality control for our lab, make sure they're up to par. We did have a new hire. I just put her in the lab. She'll be reevaluated after 5-6 weeks. Her name is Kristen Salon. We just got done cleaning the air vac station C, which is the news storage tank. We are still on schedule to do the ELPS and the airport air vac station. CleanCo, they're the ones doing the project at the plant. We just did the startup on the new lift station on the plant property. Also, CleanCo, we just finished up the paving behind the plant. They are scheduled to have all punch lists done by the 30th, hopefully. After everything is done and up to par, I'm wanting to have an open house for everybody to come, Board of Works and you guys.
He's working really hard at getting things looking really nice down in paint and such, and doing a good job with that, Marcus. It was great.
In collections, we did hire Thomas Tyler last week. He transferred the street department. He's doing really well so far. Also, we assisted the water department on multiple curb stop repairs. Assisted the street department on multiple storm drain prep and repairs. We assisted the golf course on the line break on hole number 2. We removed it and replaced the line for the pond drainage. Currently, we are getting quotes on getting lines redone. A couple of companies are in essential form, so relining the thing instead of putting new lines in and going put a sleeve in, make it sturdy. Unfortunately, our 40 miles underground is old, so we're going forward with that. Lucas Street lift station is still under construction. That's in front of the scrapyard. And also, we just put out a press release to be sent out today, shot us sent out, for our scheduled cleanings of storm drains and sewer lines starting next Monday.
You're busy. Yes, sir. Any questions for Marcus? Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Marcus.
Derek. Derek Conway, the water department. This is our new guy.
I'm glad you sat down as you didn't have to show her.
You know, if he didn't mention that, something would be wrong, you know.
The month of May, the water department did the following duties. We read meters, did orders, prepared to replace bad meters, locates backwash filter beds, shut off, swept them off the plant, mowed multiple times, made sure all the well houses and towers were ready for summer, turned on sprinkler meters, replaced the meter guts in the 1.5-inch meter at Eagles Lodge, put stone in at 10th and Monroe Street. Obviously, you're gonna see some of these patches that were done. EMV's already taken care of all of our patches. We put coal patch in at 15th and Main, and EMV came back and actually patched that the right way. We assisted Peerless Midwest on our valve maintenance with our filter bed system. We changed out 2 original valves and replaced them with two new 12-inch valves. We have now also changed out the last 2 6-inch valves on that old plant side as well. Replaced the guts in the 2-inch hydro meter at the Rochester Iron and Metal, which is the scrapyard. Assisted Peerless Midwest on our valve maintenance with our filter beds in the new plant. We changed out 6 original valves and replaced them with new valves. There were 2 4-inch, 2 8-inch, and 2 12-inch valves. We installed a blind flange on at the overhead fill pipe out of the gas pumps. Put back black dirt around the outside pit at 1528 Audubon Street. Raised the curb box at 516 Fulton Avenue and put black dirt and grass seed in there as well. Also raised the curb box at 2006 White Creek Drive and put black dirt and grass seed around it. Lowered the hydrant valve box at 1530 Audubon. Ran the weed eater around the plant, tower sites, and well houses. Traced the service line out at 1664 Park Road to locate the curb stop. Cut out the blacktop around the curb box at 2411 State Road 14 and moved the box over. The sewer department assisted us with the backer on that. Digs that were performed, we replaced a broken curb stop at 219 Fulton Avenue. And then there's a list of call outs. If you guys have any questions, I'll take them on that.
You're busy also.
Yes. We're also in the middle of starting the Monroe Street project.
Right. It's off to a pretty good start.
They're moving pretty good. Today they found an old abandoned gas line though. And then they also found a service line too that we assisted them in repairing it.
It's interesting,
John knows this, but the rest of the council, this Monroe Street water main replacement for five blocks, 18th up to 14th. We've had several leaks over the last...
At least eight that I know of.
At least eight over the last almost number, same number of years, maybe 9 years. And it just got to the point where it's time. We've got to do some of the infrastructure. So, and there was enough money in the cash reserves for the water department to tackle this. And it's thought, okay, let's spend some of the cash reserve money now on getting the infrastructure taken care of so we don't have to worry about going after a swimming pool in the future down there. It's just and we've gotten into it now, and it's really...
And about every
rough.
Leak that I've been on, it's always been when it's 15, 20
yeah.
years, so.
Yeah.
It's right now, it's currently a 4-inch, 3/4 of the way down, and it increases to 6-inch, and we're putting 8-inch all the way through. With all new hydrants, all new curb stops, all new pits, all new surface lines, everything will be brand new.
But a lot of people don't think about it, but, you know, bureaucrats don't like to spend a lot of money on things people can't see. Boy, oh boy, we've got to pay more attention to our infrastructure and dig into these things. On this project, we've also found our 10-inch sewer line, and it's in pretty rough shape. So that's one of the items Marcus has on his list. We've got to get it relined. And that's so we don't have a major issue while we're doing this project. It's that thin, okay, and we've got some holes and such. We're going to get that taken care of while we're in there. So it's all about your infrastructure. And Derek, you've done a great job of taking an old facility down there to water department and getting it.
Yeah, we're actually doing the painting project on the inside of the plant right now too. So they're painting all the walls and then all the piping as well. So the old plant walls are almost complete. They have one long wall to do and then one of the short walls, and then every wall's been painted in the plant. So
I would encourage any of you up here that if you get some time, sometime, drop down and see what he's done at the water department. It's pretty impressive. John,
you
know. Yep.
You might stay a little bit right now due to the paint, but other than that, we should be good.
Does anybody have any questions for Gary? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Lenny, that's the street department.
Broken chains in Manasol Mountain. Been maintaining
maintaining the trash in the restrooms and fixing some bleachers at the minor league diamond.
You're busy too.
Yeah, I got a few things going on.
I might add for the council, but Lenny's been doing a great job with the fact too that he's shorthanded. Two of the people that some of the folks talked about here that they just picked up, Marcus over at the waste treatment plant, picked up a former street department worker who bid on the job over at the waste treatment plant, and Derek picked up a street department worker to go on the water department. And these are great, great folks that are wanting to advance themselves and get into the areas where they can get certifications such and improve their stead in life. So we don't have any problem with people doing that, but it leaves Lenny shorthanded. Now, you've replaced one of those individuals,
yeah,
correct?
Yeah.
And hopefully we'll be replacing the other one very soon.
This week, we're looking at an interview with another young man. He's got a CDL he brings to the plate, so that'll be a big plus in my world.
Yeah. So, good job.
Yeah.
Any questions for Lenny? Okay, Randy Williams.
Good evening.
Good evening, Randy.
4th Street, they started tree removal on Ohio and 4th this week, and the project is set to start July 9th. 7th Street, the as-built prints and last pay application have been approved. So that one's winding down. The LED lighting, between the contractor's count and what Duke had as far as the city's accounts, there was a discrepancy, so they're working to resolve this. Then they'll start the design for the LED lighting for the city.
Right, and if I could interject here, Randy, what's going on? You know, this is the project to replace all the lights in the city with LED lights. There have been several changes of ownership of utility company over the years. And these lights are 50 years old. So the inventory from public service to Duke to whatever has gotten a little skewed along the line. So they've now done a physical count.
Hey, Ted,
trying to get those.
Ted, I'd like to interject on something I've seen today. You might want to address that tomorrow, but evidently they're moving them old poles that are on 9th Street. And I seen that they augered holes down beside the existing ones. They're just leaving the holes barren. No barrels or nothing.
Where's this at?
Down 9th Street. Like from Rochester Meat and Deli on down to like the bridge area. I seen a few.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's not a good thing. Maybe, how many holes are we talking, Lenny?
I seen three. Three of them like that.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they make shallow holes.
Let's get barrels there as quickly as we can in the morning, and then I'll get with them and we'll figure out what they're doing.
I'm not sure that we have an extra spare set.
Yeah, I know we're a little strapped right now. Yeah. Something, cones or something. And then I'll get a hold of them. But that's, wow, glad you saw that. We'll get on that first thing. Sorry, go ahead.
The fence at Sledding Hill is completed. Then completed the asset management plan for the city, submitted it to INLTAP and Pat Connor for review. The parking lot at 7th and Madison, the lighting is being, the posters installed for the basis for the post. I'm meeting with Airmarking next week for the striping, and they'll be adding handicap parking, 8 permanent parking in the spaces. And then the work on the new generator should start in the next couple weeks for City Hall. And I'm also meeting with the Duke engineer tomorrow on the 7th Street and Madison Street parking lot to remove the two poles that are there.
Okay.
Right in front of the door.
So that's all I got.
Got a lot of projects. You're adding them all up between the street department and the water department and the waste treatment department, Randy. We've got a lot of things going on. Of course, you mentioned the renovation, the construction of the project at 7th Street, the parking lot. Mentioned that. And Derek's, of course, got the Monroe Water Main project that you're involved in, working with the engineers also. And then the Peace Tree project that we just completed. And then the 4th Street project. Actually, July the 9th is quote-unquote the construction start, but we're in it already because there's some trees to be taken down.
Right.
So there's a lot going on. Anybody got any questions for Randy?
What are they going to do to make the Peace Tree Village one way then anyway?
Signage.
Just signage.
Yeah. Down there to see the pavement.
There'll be a stop sign right there as you're coming. If you're coming, go to the south of or the north of Kroger's Drive on Peace Street Road. Come up there to the little island there. If you take, go right to Taco Bell. There'll be a stop sign there with a right turn only sign and an arrow. And then as you're coming up off of 25, that'll all be two lanes. One will be turning into RVs where you can go and then turn by to go to Taco Bell or just proceed to the west, going up to Kroger's. With then when you're coming out of RV's Drive, there'll be a sign over there that says no right turn and a couple do not enter signs as you're coming to the east.
Yeah, it's gonna look so much better.
Yeah.
And you know, the delivery trucks, of course, have just been running over the pipes like crazy. It's just been mowing them down. So that'll take care of all of that. Anything else for Randy? Thank you, Randy.
Thank you.
Okay, committee reports, Area Planning Commission, Karen.
There was no meeting.
You got it.
I know.
Thank you. Vidco, Councilman Goodman.
As a reporter, it was made official David Heide is now the vice president. Terry met with the theater group, attended their meeting. They're meeting biweekly. I reported last meeting that they had some turnover at the top. Two people left the board. So they're a little bit unorganized, but they formed new groups. Right now they're trying to raise 20% of the $120,000 for the MSRP grant by September. So members are working to secure the 24 needed. They're looking to raise money for that instead of depending on a grant through the Community Foundation. Harry Webb mentioned that the Community Foundation money is critical to the MSRP grant application for scoring. We finally, Frank Boley is now a property owner. We're planning to close on that property.
He's now a taxpayer.
He's a taxpayer.
Right, Terry.
Yeah,
yay.
The governor's work ethics certification is starting in Rochester and Caston next school year. Companies that are currently committed to offering incentive to students that graduate with the certification are Mike Anderson, Top Industries, and Rochester Metal Products. Ivy Tech and Indiana University also have scholarships available specific to the certification. Terry's working on putting together a gathering with the employers and the schools to go over the certification. One of the big things we're facing right now is workforce, and this is something the state's trying to do to prepare some of those graduates coming into the workforce. It's not going to be, as far as I understand, it's not going to be a give me certification. They're going to have to work hard for it, and then we have companies that are agreeing to incentivize someone coming with that certification. We're getting closer to on the business and incubator space. Right now, it's trying to line up tenants to help cover the cost. It's an ongoing thing. We met more about the Community Readiness Initiative, which is basically something you need to do working towards Stellar. It's kind of like getting a loan. You got approved to the bank. You don't need the money, then you can get the money. Same thing with, you know, the community readiness initiative is getting projects you have in your wheelhouse started, moving toward the stellar. Finally, Terry was contacted by a broker representing Wings, etc., looking at some property. Not sure if that's going anywhere, but if it were to happen, then we'd be looking for a tax abatement. And then Terry will have his report for you guys, which he did email. That's my report, unless anyone has any questions.
Anybody have any questions for Councilman Goodman? Thank you, Ryan. Art Ford, Mason?
All right, we did have the disc golf tournament again. We talked in earlier meetings on wanted to host a tournament here. We did host a tournament at our new course. We had 47 attendees from Indiana and Michigan. Everyone who participated got a t-shirt, three discs, and that was part of the tournament. They had to use those three discs in the tournament. They couldn't bring their own. Parks program, or summer parks program, is off to a good start. I'm sure we'll know more, a lot more by the next meeting. They did talk about investigating a program for older children, though. That's something that has been brought up in the past. There have been quite a few people that there's still a need for the teenage group or something, so it's something they're going to look at in the future. And the pool, Lori said they had a great opening weekend, and many people bought passes early this year, so she was optimistic. On May 27th, she found damage in the pool due to overnight vandalism. And of course, the motion sensor cameras did not pick up the vandalizers. So she has RTC out there trying to get that issue fixed with the cameras. She did order new filters that we discussed last month. I think she has 36 filters that have probably never been replaced, and they're $500 a piece. And so she's been repairing them as needed, but is starting to, she's going to start ordering, you know, 4 to 6 at a time, and hopefully over a few years get them replaced. So I think she ordered 6 on this first batch. It's just going to replace the first 6 and try to mend the others that are bad. Lenny did his report, so I'll skip down to the golf course. Said the course is in great condition, but they're still having irrigation issues. They ordered parts for the verticutter that should arrive, which would have arrived by now. There has been sand, rock, and gravel out at the parking lot by the pavilion over by the old car barn. They have cleaned that up and put up the concrete barricades to keep those separated. And then signposts for the new sponsor signs are being painted. And that is all for the park board meeting.
I'd like to comment on the swimming pool filters. That's a, it's interesting. That's a pretty intricate part of the whole program out there. And these are not like filters you think of. They're cloth. As I understood, they're pretty intricate, but we've been nursing these things along because of the cost ever since Stan Musgrave's days, you know, repairing them. So the process now is we'll replace them out with a couple of here just to get on top of that. They apparently last quite a while if you use some maintenance on them. So, but they're a pretty important part. Any questions for Mason?
Yeah, Mason, were the cameras for the vandalism, were they positioned the wrong way or they were a malfunction?
I'm not sure she did. All right. Couldn't tell you.
Was there any mention about the sign on the skate park? I had called you about it. The kids had scratched off. There were no bikes on that. No.
I'll check that out. One thing I forgot to elaborate on, Ted, is I think it was the 16th, the Whippoorwill Church and the Cross Church youth groups met out there at the park at like 8 o'clock Saturday morning, and they worked till like noon cleaning up the park as part of the thing, some kind of thing they had going on with the churches. So I forgot to thank them when I was up there giving my report.
If you bring me the contact person, sure. Send them a thank you note.
Absolutely.
Anything else for Mason? Okay, Redevelopment Commission, Terry Lee.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, Terry.
Just mention one other thing quickly on the FEDCO side of things. After our last two business planning classes, which were pretty well attended, it was pretty evident that there was a demand for a class on just financial statements. So we are holding a class August 22nd. We're limited to 30 people in that class. We've got a gentleman coming from Colorado. We looked through two or three different vendors for this. We've got him coming in from Colorado on August 22nd. It's a day-long class. He's going to talk about the fun of balance sheets and income statements and cash flow statements and those kind of things. But from our business planning classes, it looked like there was quite a bit of interest in that. It's not going to be self-sufficient in terms of what we're going to be able to charge for. We're going to keep the cost low. But we have funds in our USDA revolving loan interest account that we're going to use, and then also some of our technical assistance from USDA for that. And then also we're going to host a five-minute pitch, a business pitch competition in the fall, October probably. We hope to award up to $10,000. We're working on sponsors for that right now. We've got a meeting Thursday night with a potential sponsor for that. So it's basically like a business plan competition, but it's really not a business plan. It's more of a pitch. So we'll look for some information on that coming up, marketing materials coming out on that. On the Redevelopment Commission side, on the Nickel Plate Trail, we're getting closer. Design plan and stormwater protection plan are done. We're waiting on item on the Rule 5 permit DNR on their comments on the design. We hope to have it out to bid sometime in the month of July. And then also, we are still looking at a trailhead building at basically the House of Decor lot, is how people know it. So Todd Van Sickle is here. He's with another.
Hey, Todd.
Are you in the same class as?
No, previous class, Fulton County Leadership from 2 years ago.
2 years ago. Todd's been working with me on the Trailhead building. I think right now we have about $185,000 budget on that project. We're putting in a letter of intent with the community foundation tomorrow, unless Jay already has it. And then Todd's going to be leading the crowdfunding program to get additional funding for that. And then we'll be at the Parks Board meeting, I think the 9th. Make sure the Parks Board is on with our plan for the Trailhead building and the location. The council's passed anyway, as we've worked on this project, have agreed to take over ownership of the building, maintenance and ownership of the building. So we want to go to the Parks Board next or week after next and talk to those guys, make sure we are working with any. It came up with a frame building versus a block building for a restroom, that kind of thing. So we want the Park Board's feedback on it before we get too far along with our budget. And then we'll be back in front of the council to give you an update on both the budget and fundraising at next month's meeting. And Todd wants to talk about, don't you?
Oh, yeah, sure, I do.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity.
On with the program. Any questions for me?
Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you today. From the Fulton County Leadership Academy, 2 years ago, our project basically was to learn. I learned about the trail system moving into town, looked at the trail system, and then talked to other people in the town, including Terry, about the trail extension that could happen this fall and the need for a trailhead facility. The trailhead facility serves as a gateway to our community. It does lots of things like promote healthy lifestyles, business development. There's a lot of studies that say a vibrant trail system helps retain employees and helps recruit new employers and employees to the community. So the Fulton County Leadership Team is working with the Indiana Housing Community Development Authority and a crowdfunding opportunity where we're going to raise $50,000 in the community from trail supporters, individuals, and businesses. That would be matched dollar for dollar with a grant from the Indiana Housing Community Development Authority So there's 100 of the 185,000. We've approached the Community Foundation with a grant for the 85,000. We're going to try to time that all with the completion of the trail extension, or at least the first phase of that for this fall. I just wanted to give you an update that we're still working on that and making progress. We as a Fulton County Leadership Academy have done all our legwork for that. We just need some feedback from the Community Foundation, and then we'll run our campaign this fall, hopefully. Any questions about the trail and facility?
No, other than thank you for your involvement, Todd.
Thank you.
Now, these projects, Valerie was just here, you, they're not easy projects, and they're time consuming. So thank you for your efforts.
Thank you for your support.
Okay, the Rochester DCA and Council on Aging, Marty?
Yep.
Should think about a half an hour for this report. I got to read this document here, Dave. No. BZA meets tomorrow night. On their agenda is one item, and as Mason mentioned about exceptions and rules, this is a deck on a property out at the lake, which that's at least half of what they hear about throughout a year, but that's tomorrow night. Yesterday, Council on Aging met. Kind of a shorter meeting. The rides are down a little bit, but still averaging over 150 a day.
Jesus.
Picking up a 12 passenger new bus tomorrow. That will handle some of the special needs people. The old one had, I don't know, almost 300,000 miles on it, I believe. So they are holding an NDOT meeting for Northern Indiana there tomorrow. So about 40 people from out of town will be over at the center. It looks nice. There was no RSV report, and RSVP report, and was on vacation. The council made about $5,000 on a little over $5,000 on their golf outing. And for the month of May, there were 3,607 rides given. That concludes my report. If there's any questions.
Those drivers are more active than UPS, aren't they?
There's
a lot of mileage.
Jizzy. Mm-hmm.
Any questions for council?
There's some talk that they're I think I mentioned they're actually working on maybe expanding the hours a little bit. Some local employers have inquired, and there's some discussion going on about maybe having some earlier hours.
I was just going to ask that. What are their actual hours that they operate?
Oh, you would have to ask.
Because I know that it's a limited amount of time. When you think of that many rides, and it's like seven to five thirty.
I'm not sure on the end time. Yeah.
So you can look at the month of May, 3,600 is a change in rides by 7 to 5:30 working day.
Right. Yeah, I've been sitting here for a few years now. We've never heard of an incident. That is just phenomenal.
Well, there's been one small one.
Oh my gosh, I didn't do that. Not gun.
But no, it is a lot of miles with a lot of drivers, and they're very conscientious. Every now and then, hear a few things from somebody who says, "Hey, dog driver not really doing too good of a job," but those are very, very few and far between. We have excellent volunteers that are drivers, paid drivers that do that job, do it very well.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, they do a great job.
Any questions for Marty? Solid Waste and Animal Adoption Center, Chase.
The Animal Adoption Center, numbers are in the packet that you can look at. And then also for them, there's going to be a golf outing on, actually this weekend, June 30th. Check-ins at 2 o'clock and shotgun starts at 2:30. I still think they're looking for a few more players. For solid waste, the recycling center ships 97 tons of recyclables with a value of $6,262.98. For the month of April, County Line Landfill received 35,884 tons of waste in 21 working days for a daily average of 1,709 tons per day. Fulton County accounted for 4,761 tons. The rest of Indiana contributed 31,114 tons. There was 8.7 tons of out-of-state trash, and the host fee for the month was $47,879.02. The county host fee for the month of April was $15,561.46. Since our last meeting, for the solid waste meeting, they sold 339 orange bags, bringing the total sales to 4,003, of which 1,801 were purchased by city residents, and 2,200 were purchased by county residents. And they collected $2,425 for disposal of bulk items. And other than that, really, that's about it. She's going to be getting a quote for maybe remodeling the whole building. She got a quote for some paint, but they're kind of, I think the board was kind of unanimous on seeing what the quote would be for trying to remodel the room and make it last longer.
Any questions for Jason? I suppose it might be possible sometime in the future for us to get a presentation from the Animal Adoption Center.
Yeah, I asked her about that. I did ask her about that last month, actually. I'll ask Jana, and I think she definitely wanted to come. So,
a lot of things have happened since the last time you were here, or anyone was here.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Chase. Water Board, John Garrett.
June 6th, Water Board meeting. The Monroe Street project, of course, as Derek said earlier, has been signed, and it was signed to proceed on May 30th. Plant operator updates where the main valves or the filler beds on the new plant, the old plant, have been replaced with new ones. Quotes for seal coating the drives at the plant, well house, and 18th Street tower. Siders asphalt maintenance was $2,760. Q&L seal coating, $4,500. Ranger seal coating, no quote. And of course, they took the Siders asphalt maintenance. Quotes for the new concrete pad down at the lower shed for storing our filler material for digs. Todd Brooks, $15,850. LG Concrete, $14,914.76. And it was to LG. No old business, and Derek was the employee's taking vacation. His name went on the list, but didn't pay attention to the rest of them. And for the business, it was all over.
Okay. Any questions for John? Thank you, John. Okay, the Rochester Downtown Partnership, Harry Webb.
Not sure why you saved little best for last, but not least. Basically, as you know, Living Local Fest is going on this weekend, and Tina gave me just a quick report that she has secured the portable restrooms and the handicap accessible ratio proper, and she also has the trash pickup lined up. There are several local food vendors. They aren't going to be offering full meals, they're going to be offering tastes. Kind of the whole point is to kind of get the people to come and get to taste a lot of different, and it's all local folks that are doing it in the area, so it's kind of nice. It's a
How many does she have there, you know?
I should have brought that postcard in, but I think it's around 10.
Our board meeting is actually later this week, so I'm going to pull up a date, but it looks like it's going to be a good event. It's going to be very hot. That coupled with the ski show should be a fun filled day.
Do you know how many entrants are in the parade?
I do not.
Okay.
That's the chamber's analyst on the parade, so.
Okay. Chief, have you heard?
But they didn't make it free this year, so that should help. There's been several complaints in the past about the fees of the big charge, so hopefully there'll be more can turn out for that. Pat Jacobs has been in town three times, measuring up and meeting with building owners on the MSRP project, and she has pretty much met with all of them who have paid. We still have a couple possible projects, properties that haven't closed yet, haven't finished up, possible transition. That one being the possible dugout property, and the other being the Van Dyne purchase of, if they end up doing a bigger space, they may enter that into the software directive if all that happens before this is due. She did make some comments that she's involved in the VinSense project, and she was very disappointed in how high the bid came in. They only had one bidder, and the bids came in almost 30% higher than what they had estimated. So I've cautioned her to make sure she estimates high when putting together her cost estimates on this construction, so the building owners know up front what it potentially could be. And we may be talking about adding on a, of course this money goes into escrow prior to the application of the grant, but she says the community has done a built-in contingency. OCRA does not allow a contingency fee in the quote. Basically, when you estimate what it's going to be, there is no contingency fee in that, but you can estimate high based on historical numbers. And but some communities have built in a contingency fee for each particular project that the city would also hold in that escrow. Just, and if that project ended up costing more than when it gets finally bid, more than what they would have that at least a little bit of.
I would think, I know if I was a contractor going to work on 10 old facades, I'd make sure I had my money, I had everything covered.
Yeah.
And had a cushion. You know?
Yeah.
Because it's like an onion, isn't it?
Sure.
You know, at first hand.
Sure.
Yep. A lot of unknowns.
So that'll, the next phase will be that she is, as they've already completed some of the drawings, but then the next phase will be, she'll be coming back with building owners and coming up with a concept drawing and some cost estimates and figure out what they like and don't like about that as we work towards that project.
Okay, so
I had.
Anybody got a question for Harry? Thank you, sir. Thanks for waiting, Harry. It's
breaking on down that way.
Shot it makes up the line.
I know.
Okay, if you would like to go first, by golly, I'm going to put you right up here ahead.
There you go.
I'll take that.
Thanks, Harry. Appreciate it. Okay, we have no ADA concerns. Anything from the legal department? Could you speak up, Andy?
A little bit. I went to the Indiana Municipal Lawyers Conference Thursday and Friday, and they discussed several legal bills, and one of the ones that kind of caught my interest has to do with some of these problem properties that we've discussed in the past.
Okay.
What it would do is give Rochester an opportunity, if we get notice in 40 days prior to a tax sale, to actually subject to some required issues. So we always think of the problem in the past. We've got a property that's not meeting certain requirements, 12 grad zoning requirements, back room, whatever. This will allow us, given the proper notice, set out before the tax sale, allow the auditor to make it an inherent part of the bid. So someone who takes the certificate
good. Some progress in that area. Anything else?
Nothing else other than these parties.
Okay. All right, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Those in favor?
Are we supposed to raise our hand?
Thank you.